Okay, so what I was telling you that I will try to give you an idea on aspects of the clinical pathways where there is still a need to improve for head and neck cancer care. So these are my disclosures. I would like to remind you that head and neck cancer may be cured by surgery or by radiation or by a combination of them. So the clinical decision making is complex and needs to be taken by a multidisciplinary team. So my suggestion is that exactly because we may have to decide between two major procedures to treat a head and neck cancer patients, maybe, or the suggestion is that the multidisciplinary team should be part of the healthcare pathway in these cancers. So clearly the decision will have to be appropriate by possibly adopting the treatment standards, and this can be done through adopting available treatment guidelines. We know that head and neck cancer presentations are very heterogeneous, and evidences are often lacking due to the case complexity, a typical presentation, uncertainty about data, about generalization of data that came from randomized trial. On top of it, we also know that they do these recommendations and clinical guidelines are really not taking into account patients' preferences. So I think that in this regard, the MDT, the multidisciplinary team decision making, reflects the most effective way to deliver an appropriate and individualized treatment plan. A given hospital may lack the needed experts, especially when treating rare cancers. An MDT group should not be necessarily working in the same building, and healthcare providers may exploit MDT organization within referral networks, for example, that may provide all the needed professional to better serve an individual decision making. From this perspective, from the perspective of the healthcare provider, the organization of team working requires resource allocation. This means that providing high quality care has added costs, and this is not always accepted and may require negotiation with hospital administrators. In the context of MDT working, quality criteria has been proposed. Unfortunately, these are often not known or hardly monitored in the clinical activity, also in our multidisciplinary groups. This is a list of quality criteria for the MDT working group. That has been proposed. There are several papers that look at this, that propose some of these quality criteria. An MDT is expected to deliver appropriate decisions, which include the efficiency, involvement in clinical studies, physician education, and to do this, there is a need to follow some rules, which are important for the decision making. You have, for example, to define precisely the participants that are needed for this MDT group. And this is also, what is also required is that there should be a democratic participation in these MDT discussions. how should an MDT function? It should have an agenda. These are other, there are papers suggesting that the best way in which you may be able to have a good MDT functioning, you need an agenda. There should be a case presentation which should be efficient. So it means that the case presentation is critical, the way in which you present the case in order to be efficient. Somehow you need some leadership, which it's mainly meant as someone that monitor the democratic participation of the MDT participants. There should be common pre-agreed guidelines. So it means that the group should, before meeting or in general, before when you set up an MDT group, need to pre-agree on guidelines that you will be referring to for classical decision making, for example. Controversies in MDT should be seen as incentives to further go and to improve your knowledge about controversial thinking, maybe. There should be some documentation of the decision making, and also there is a need to agree on how the activities will be reported, which way, by numbers, by criteria, quality criteria, and so on. It has to be known that a multidisciplinary cancer care may have medical legal implications. This may be different in different countries. So this, it is important to know how in each country this works. When it comes to speak about criteria and about recommendation on how to run cancer services in head and neck, for example, we do have old documents, and I think this is the first document that I've seen about how to improve outcome in head and neck cancer. This is a date, this dates back 2004, but it has been updated regularly. And as you see here, NHS provided this first document to guide outcome improvement in head and neck cancer. And this document included already 15 years ago the concept of MDT team working to improve outcome in head and neck. In the head and neck context, multidisciplinary core members' requirements were set and are reported here. Moreover, time dedicated to this activity is, as you see on the bottom of this slide, is also reported, which is quite important to know that, for example, each surgeon in the MDT should normally dedicate half of his or her time to head and neck cancer. So this is like somehow trying to qualify the type of surgeon that is needed for an efficient participation to MDT. Some individuals may need other specialists who are requested to attend only on specific requests, and here you have a list. MDT models of functioning can be classified as democratic forum or approval model. In essence, the democratic forum takes the decision and it is presented to the patient. On the contrary, the approval model includes the patient's opinion in the whole decision-making process. There is still a lack, in my opinion, of criteria by which qualifying the MDT professionals, professional participants. And so I'm proposing here a list that reflects, that just reflects my suggestions, ranging from patient volume concept to more complex audit procedures, for example. But this is still, this is really has to be further clarified, which is the best way on and how we should qualify the type of professionals, the various professionals, at least for the core members. So we try to collect evidences to support the usefulness of MDT treatment decision making for head and neck. To look at it, we try to collect data about the available guidelines in different countries that established MD working groups. In some of the countries, we found binding rules for healthcare providers. For example, you see the Netherlands, these binding rules were also including the requirement for patient centralization in few selected institutions that were allowed to treat head and neck cancers. And indeed, the outcome of patients, head and neck cancer patients in Netherlands is quite good in this way, it's competitive with other countries. So the idea behind this, behind centralization, is clear to exploit the well-known positive effect of patients' volume on cancer outcome, which includes clearly head and neck cancer. There are papers reporting about this. So patient centralization will also serve head and neck cancers. Some papers looked at which is the impact of MDT on patient management. Approximately 30% of patients discussing an MDT team may experience a change in diagnosis or treatment. And this is quite consistent with what has already been reported also in other rare cancers. Here, I'm reporting you our experience that is including more than approximately 700 patients. When we looked at the impact on cancer management for our head and neck cancer patients that were treated in our institution, basically these were the first visit, the first MDT visit in our institution. 50% of the cases required further staging procedures. And in 13% of cases, there was a change in diagnosis. And interestingly, we didn't find any major difference between common and rare head and neck types. So I'm referring to the common head and neck, the classical four subsites, pharynx, larynx, oral cavity, versus the rare head and neck types, which are salivary gland, nasopharynx, paranasal sinuses, and some rare mucosal tumors. Within the Rare Cancer Project, led by Annalisa, we tried to study quality of care indicator on epidemiological data sets. She already presented some of this data. I would like to review them with you from the perspective of really head and neck. What we did is that we first collected the type of criteria adopted in different countries. So this is the way the procedures that we adopted in order to come to this quality criteria. And this was done in collaboration with major multidisciplinary European Society for Head and Neck. So we came to a consensus on a list of quality criteria that were validated through high resolution studies in order to develop criteria for defining a center of reference that has sufficient or good expertise to treat head and neck cancer. This is the list that was elaborated. Basically, it includes if there has been a proper definition of stage, appropriate treatment starting time, items for pathological and radiotherapy quality indicators, and the presence of MDT boards, as well as availability of clinical and translational research. The study included these countries with a total of more than 8,000 patients that were distributed as you see in this slide. So it included also the big squamous cell carcinomas, the big group of squamous cell carcinomas such as hypopharynx, larynx, oral cavity, and oropharynx, subdivided as you see. Here the figures reporting about how many patients receive the proper stage definition at diagnosis for larynx versus other sites. Approximately 50% lack local staging, and this holds both for larynx and non-laryngeal one. So you may expect that for larynx there is less need for imaging, for example, which is becoming quite clear that you would need imaging also for early laryngeal cancer. But here the important part is that this is approximately the same, the same figures are seen in other sites as well. In this slide, there is data about quality of surgery expressed as complete tumor resection, which ranges between 60 to 75%. So when we are thinking about a surgical center of expertise in surgery for head and neck, we are really aiming at having 90% R0 resection. In a significant number of pathological reports, data about surgical margins were missing, and this is really something which is let us think that there is here an important message that has to be improved. This part, the pathological reporting, also because it seems really in generally very poor, since it's not including all the core data that are suggested by pathological reporting guidelines. There are recent attempts to tackle criteria defining best practice in surgical treatments. Essentially, the recommendation underlines the value of patients and physician volume, and it includes criteria to define nodal yield, surgical margins, and number of reoperations. Interesting, there might be different criteria defining best practices according to tumor subtype. So, for example, for larynx, there are data showing that MDT is very important to improve outcome of laryngeal cancer patients. On the other side, for oral cavity, time to postoperative treatment seems more important. International Radiation Therapy Quality of Care Collaboration Group started working on quality and on harmonization of quality data quality, essentially in clinical trials, but there is now a movement to try to keep to try to take and keep these quality criteria also for not only for clinical trials but also for clinical practice. There is also a question on how to optimize follow-up procedures in head and neck cancer patients, and this is something that is clearly has to do with the effectiveness of follow-up in head and neck cancer patients. There are no randomized trials. These are very difficult to be made. And so there are some discussion about if it should be high intensity follow-up or we should rely on a less intensity follow-up. For example, the NCCN guidelines on follow-up of head and neck cancer, they are really only suggesting to have one imaging after curative treatment, and then the follow-up should be just relying on symptoms reported by the patients. So clearly, this is a complex endeavor, and there are no data in support of an intensive imaging-based versus a non-intensive based approach. Unlike other type of oral cancer, follow-up has a deep significance in understanding, reporting, controlling the development of late toxicity, which have an impact on survivors' quality of life. So here, the focus of follow-up of head and neck cancer patients is much more on late sequelae rather than trying to pick up a recurrence, which mostly of the time is not curable any longer. And of course, the other important significance is to pick up a second primary cancer due to field cancerization. In this regard, the tendency is now to shift from how to follow up effectively cure patient to survivorship guidelines, which are available for head and neck, and this is really an extensive paper, which is very much focused on multidisciplinary rehabilitation of head and neck cancer patients. So here you have a list, it's just to review with you some of the suggestions, the recommendation of the American Cancer Society for survivorship care guideline, and they are taking some of the most important aspects of the most important toxicity that those patients are reporting and how we should tackle those toxicity in the survivorship. So I would like to conclude by saying that head and neck cancer community needs a wider adoption of MDT working, which for me is still something which they stays behind. It's not fully adopted, not fully understood, not fully organized. I think that we need to work on the multidisciplinary team qualification. We need equal expert professional sitting, at least equal in terms of expertise, at least sitting among the core members. We need to spread the knowledge about the presence of indicators linked to best practice in surgery and radiation oncology. And finally, we need to improve survivorship guidelines adoption. Thank you very much for your attention.